Conquer the grave, you free every captive and break it. That's better. Isn't it lovely to hear the chatter going on? It's really, really nice. Welcome to this morning's service. If you're online listening now or later, welcome. Lovely to have you with us. My name's Trev. I expect most of you know me looking around here. Most of you know who I am. But if you don't know who I am, I'm just one of the worship team here. I'm a member here. And I'm going to lead us through this morning's service and take us on through. But we have a very special guest with us this morning, Simon Gray, who's come from us. He's our regional... No, what, how do we call you? A regional minister, don't we now? Is what we call Simon. He's come to speak to us this morning and share with us, which I'm really looking forward to. In case one or two of you are wondering where Andy is, of course, he's away on his sabbatical. They've been down in Spain, and I think they're on their way back. I'm not sure whether they're back yet or they're on their way back. If you look on the notice sheet, he has sent a little video, and there's a little link on there. If you go on there, you can see a very short video of what they've been up to, which is great. So he's keeping in touch with us in that way. Just want to reiterate, this is the second week where we've changed our tea and coffee arrangements for after service. Most people are used to going straight to the back, but we've changed them now. So there's a coffee station over this side. And as Hillary said last week, she was doing all her aeroplane stuff. But there's a coffee table over there. There's also one in the prayer room, and there is a table at the back to make it a bit easier for people to go and make their own tea and coffee how they like it. Once you've got that, though, please come back in sort of more to the centre of the church so that other people can get round it all. We hope that's going to work well. We're looking at other tweaks that will make it better, but bear with us. But that's where you'll find your tea and coffee at the end of the service. So I hope that's okay with everybody. Wouldn't it be nice just to turn to the next person for 10 seconds so it's not a full conversation? Turn to the next person, either give them a hug or a handshake and say welcome. 10 seconds, there you go. Four, three, two, one, stop. There. Right, all conversations over now? Lovely. There we go. It's just nice to greet each other. Just nice to say welcome. Welcome to God's house, where we can come and we can praise the Lord. When I started to think about this service, I thought, what can we do at the beginning? And I thought, wouldn't it be nice, because it's been Easter and we're just after Easter, wouldn't it be nice just to spend a few songs just worshipping? No other reason but to say, Jesus, we love you. We want to come and we want to sing, we want to praise your name, and we want to give you the glory. So we've got three songs. If you don't wish to stand for the whole lot and you're finding it a bit much, don't worry, sit down. That's absolutely fine. But we're going to start by singing three worship songs so that we can get into the presence of God and let him enter into us. All right, so let's stand.
Love and joys forever.
to worship. It's good to praise. It's good to feel God near us. I'm just going to take it down a little bit for you so it's not so bad. And we're going to sing, I Will Worship. We just want to say thank you that we can come here freely to worship you, to be free to give you the glory and the honor, to give you the praise that you deserve. Father, we are nothing without you. Father, we worship you. We adore you. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Give me a second. Thank you. Just going to turn the handout on. Just be with me a second. There we go. Right now. Oh, I've got a few things here, which I hope will work. But it's me, so it might not. Ha ha! We shall see. Now, there's always a good thing that's going on. When you've got to think about a all-age talk, your brain goes, where do I pitch this? Where do I aim it at? Do I aim it at the adults? Do I aim it at the teenagers? Do I aim it at the little ones? Where do I aim it at? So I think about myself, and I think I'm about four. So I might aim it around about four. So there we go. Now, I'm not sure how you feel when you get upset. Does anyone get upset here? Is that because obviously we're Ashley, so does anyone actually get upset? If you do, put your hand up. Oh, someone got two hands up. Yay! Good. We do, don't we? We do get upset from time to time. And it's not always easy to sort of get rid of that upset. It gets inside us a bit, doesn't it? So I'm looking this morning, I hope some of you will be able to see this, probably not all of you, but I hope so. This bottle represents us. All right? So it's a complete bottle. It represents us. And it's empty. Now, if you're small, what happens, James, what happens when one of your brothers and sisters take a toy that you want? Do you get a bit upset? You get really angry. Yeah. Do you know what? I know. It's not easy when someone takes your toy. Steve, it's not easy when Fee takes your toy, is it? She's always taking your toys. Doesn't make you feel very good. And you get a little bit angry, so you start to turn your colour a little bit. I'm not sure. So you start to get a little bit angry. Whoops, I'm spilling on the outside as well, but hey, we'll be all right. Look at that. So we start to get a bit angry, and it starts to burble inside, doesn't it? And if we don't do anything about it, it sits there. And it sits there, and it sits there. And you're just thinking, I can cope. When your best mate at school, who you are really close to, is given captain of the team, and you know he's going to pick you first, and you stand there and you're really ready to go, and he doesn't pick you. Doesn't pick you at all. You're stood there and he's gone through all 10 other players and 11 comes up and you think, it's got to be me. No, you're back in the changing rooms, you know. Oh my word, my best friend doesn't want to know me. Blood starts to boil. Oh my word, you start to feel a little bit worse. So there we go. Whoops, spilling it again. There you go. I'm always spilling things. There you go. So then your little bit of anger starts to get a little bit more angry. Not fair, James, is it?
No.
It's not fair. I'm still coping. I'm still managing to hold it in. Not easy, but I'm holding it in. Then I go home, and my sister has eaten my last Easter egg. I'm sorry, chocolate. This is not happening. My sister has eaten all my chocolate. My chocolate, James. She's eaten all my chocolate. None left. And I was really looking forward to that. I needed that after my best mate let me down. I needed that to make me feel better. Oh, am I angry? Oh, am I angry? Oh, dear, yeah. Now, that's not good. That's horrible, isn't it? That's really... Isn't that nasty? That's what happens inside us when we let anger get hold of us. And that's really nasty. Well, without pouring it out that way, am I going to get it out? Well, see, everyone keeps telling me, this God that we've got is absolutely amazing. Now, who should we choose as God? Should I choose a green God? I'm going to choose a green God. This is God, all right? Looks like God, doesn't it? No? Hang on a minute. A little bit of God's love. A little bit more of God's love. A huge amount more of God's love. Now, we all know that we need God's love. We all know that he needs to come inside and he needs to take charge of our lives so that we can get rid of this anger. But that's no good up here and we're down there. So let's see what we can do.
Give it a little bit extra love because we might need it. Now, if
I put that over the top of there, whoops, which is God coming into our lives, shall we see what will happen? Oh, I missed the top of the bottle. That's not good. Don't miss the top of the bottle, because it does work if you get it over the bottle. And then you find God's love inside us makes a huge, huge difference. Sometimes we have to wait a while for it all to go. Sometimes God needs to work on us rather a lot. Whoa! Doesn't he? Sometimes, I'm sure, each and every one of us knows that sometimes it doesn't just go like that. It takes a little while to work. But when it does, God's love is inside us and he's making us clean. Yeah? So you just remember, when you have a tough time at school or a tough time at home or wherever you might be, and that anger's welling up inside, you need to think of Jesus. You need to let Jesus in, and he will empty out that bad stuff, and he'll make us clean, and he'll make us whole. Yeah? Good. Well, I'm going to move this to the side before I drop everything else. Right, I'm just going to pray for the children before they go out, so they're going to go out in a minute. So let's just pray. Father, we pray for all our youngsters, for all their teachers, and for all, each and every one of them, that as they're out in the Sunday school at the back, Lord, that you will be with them, that you will help them, that you will give them messages that is right for their age, messages that they can take into their hearts, so that they know that you love them, Jesus, that you love and each and every one of them. Be with them now as they go. Amen. Now, as the children go out, I'm going to ask Jan to come and give us our reading.
Good morning. The reading today is from Mark chapter 2, verses 13 to 17, the calling of the Levi. Once again, Jesus went out beside the lake. A large crowd came to him, and he began to teach them. As he walked along, he saw Levi, son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax collector's booth. "Follow me," Jesus told him, and Levi got up and followed him. While Jesus was having dinner at Levi's house, many tax collectors and sinners were eating with him and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. When the teachers of the law, who were Pharisees, saw him eating with the sinners and tax collectors, they asked his disciples, "Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners?" On hearing this, Jesus said to them, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners."
Thank you, Jan. We're going to stand and sing another song, "How Deep the Father's Love for Us." Let's stand.
Beyond all measure.
Please be seated.
We're just going to take a moment to pray for the situation in the Middle East. There's Pete Gregg is the founder of the 24/7 prayer movement, and he's put some words that I'm going to be using as our time of prayer today. So let's pray together. Pete writes, "It's natural to feel hopeless and helpless in a crisis like this. And it can be tempting to simply bury our heads in the sand. But we are called instead to take a stand in prayer. The Apostle Paul reminds us that behind this physical violence, there is a spiritual battle. We pray for the people of Israel, Iran, and Gaza. Those terrified, grieving, and displaced. Those ordinary, innocent families caught up in this conflict on every side. Lord, have mercy. We pray for the politicians, for wisdom beyond human wisdom, diplomacy, and an unexpected de-escalation. Let warmongering and opportunism be thwarted. Defense systems be effective. And peacemaking prevail. Lord, have mercy. We pray for medics, for hospitals, for aid workers trying to get resources to where they are needed most. Lord, have mercy. And we pray for the people of God preparing to gather for Sunday worship in this region where the church began. In Iran, the church is growing faster than anywhere else in the world, but it is fiercely persecuted. We pray, therefore, for continued courage to point people to the Prince of Peace, and that the Spirit would anoint our brothers and sisters in Christ, even now, especially now, to proclaim the good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to comfort all who mourn, and to provide for those who grieve in Zion. Lord, have mercy. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, the Prince of Peace. Amen. And a reminder that we can pray for things more locally this afternoon at 5:45 for our Rock prayer meeting at 6:00 if you want to come and pray for things more local and a bit of national as well.
Thanks, Fee. That's good. So much going on in this world. But just before Simon comes to preach to us, let's just pray for Simon as we prepare for the sermon. Father, we thank you that Simon's been able to come and join with us this morning to bring your message, to bring what you want to say to us this morning. Thank you for his preparation. Thank you for his time. And Father, we pray now that you will fill him with your Holy Spirit as he speaks to us. Amen.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to be able to be with you this morning, and I bring greetings from Southern Counties Baptist Association. That is the association of around 150 Baptist churches and missional communities around the south of England, from Emsworth in the east to Weymouth in the west, and up to Banbury in the north, not forgetting the Isle of Wight and Guernsey. And so I'm part of the regional team at Southern Counties, and I work, part of my role is to work with around 50 churches along the south coast there, so the strip from Emsworth across to Weymouth, of which you're part, and the other part is to work with some of the operational part of the association. And as I go round, what I like to do is pass greetings from one church to another. And so I bring greetings from Central Baptist Church in Southampton. I was there last Sunday. I'd ask you to pray for them. They're a church that's going through quite a difficult time at the moment. But there's that sense of God being at work. And we don't quite know what the future is for the church there, but there is a glimmer of hope, whereas a few months ago there looked as if there might be no hope. So please pray for them. And if it's all right with you, I will pass your greetings on to, now wait for this, Milford-on-Sea Baptist Church. The idea of doing this is to demonstrate something of the spread of the association. And that normally works, but occasionally it doesn't. I'm there in a couple of weeks' time. So if it's all right with you, I'll pass your greetings on to them. But I'm sure you know something about them anyway. Another thing I like to do when I go round is to thank the churches for their support of Home Mission, both financially and through prayer. And if you don't know what Home Mission is, we're going to watch a short video that just gives you a little update as to where that money and prayer support that you give goes to. So if we could have.
Way back in Deuteronomy in chapter 14, God sets out his priorities for mission giving. His people were to set aside a proportion of everything their fields produced to give back to him. And then at the end of every third year, they were to use what they'd saved to support the Levites, they were the priests, but also the widows, the fatherless, and the refugees living among them. Well, by giving to Home Mission, you are doing just that. You're supporting those who serve God's people, including the national specialist teams. For example, those offering safeguarding and legal advice, ministry support such as counselling for ministers, and the joint public issues team who engage with government on our behalf on issues of social justice and faith. Then there's the regional team who offer hands-on support to churches and ministers, especially in times of need, and who work to inspire, connect and resource all of our churches to reach their communities for Christ. But most importantly, mission projects that reach people where they are with the love and hope of Christ. Whether it's through an established church, a pioneering project, or a chaplaincy, these Home Mission grants make possible so much amazing ministry that goes on within our association. Let me show you a couple of examples of SCBA projects that Home Mission supports. On behalf of the regional team, the whole association, and countless others you will never meet, I want to say a huge thank you for supporting Home Mission. I do need to be honest with you and let you know that rather than increasing every year as the needs increase, giving to Home Mission has actually been decreasing over recent years. And so if you as an individual, as a family, or as a church are able to support Home Mission through a one-off gift or a standing order, we will be so grateful. Either go to scba.org.uk/homemission or scan the QR code at the bottom of the screen using the camera on your phone. Or if you have an idea for a new project or ministry and would like to find out about receiving a Home Mission grant, then do get in touch. Many thanks and God bless you.
So thank you on behalf of Baptist Together and of Southern Counties Baptist Association for your support. If you want to find out any more about those particular projects that you saw glimpses of in that video, if you go to the Southern Counties website, there are full videos for each of those projects if you want to find out more about them and the way in which God is at work through those projects across our region. So we're looking, as we heard earlier, of part of Mark chapter 2, as you sort of continue your journey through Mark's gospel. And we're going to look particularly at those verses that we heard read earlier. But before we do that, if we take a slight step back into chapter 1, we see that Jesus begins his ministry, and Mark records it like this. Mark chapter 1, verses 14 and 15. After John was put into prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. And then as we progress through the rest of chapter 1 and through into chapter 2, we see the first signs of what this kingdom looks like. Now, I imagine that last week you looked at something of what the kingdom was. By way of shorthand, I define the kingdom of God as this, where what God wants done is done. It's quite a simple, but I think that's quite helpful, where what God wants done is done. It's a bit of a tongue twister, but it sums up to me what the kingdom of God is. And so as we read through chapter 1 and on into chapter 2, we see signs of the kingdom. We see healings. We see someone who was afflicted by a demon, someone who had a fever, someone with leprosy, and then someone who was paralyzed. So we see that the kingdom of God is a place of healing. And then at the beginning of chapter 2, we see that it's a place of forgiveness. As that man who was paralyzed came to Jesus, was brought to Jesus, he was forgiven of his sins. So we see that the kingdom is a place of healing and of forgiveness. And then alongside these signs of the kingdom, we see that Mark records some of the people who Jesus calls to experience the kingdom and to be part of what God is doing, this place where God rules and God reigns. Again, we go back to chapter 1 and we see that Jesus calls some fishermen to follow him. So we see Simon and Andrew, James and John. Jesus heals a man who had leprosy, a man who, according to the Old Testament, must be excluded, a man who was seen as unclean and was to be kept at a distance. Jesus touches this so-called untouchable man and heals him, welcoming him to experience the kingdom. And then as we move into chapter 2, we see that familiar story of the paralyzed man being brought down through the ceiling, literally to the feet of Jesus. A man who would, in all probability, have spent his day lying on the street corner, begging for money. He at least has some friends who bring him to Jesus. And as he meets Jesus, he experiences the reality of the kingdom through healing and forgiveness. And then in the account that we've just read, Jesus calls Levi, this tax collector, to be part of his kingdom. And it's at this point that we read that the religious authorities begin to get a little bit upset. It's almost as if they're saying, well, the fishermen were fine. Well, the leper, we could just about see what you were doing there. But a tax collector and his friends, now, Jesus, you've gone too far. Tom Wright, the theologian, sort of compares Levi the tax collector with a modern-day traffic warden. Any traffic wardens in? Please say no. No, okay, we're all right, we're good to go. And so you've got a traffic warden who spends his or her time looking for people that have stepped outside of the rules. It's a job where you need a thick skin, where you need to deal with those excuses. Well, I was only 5 minutes over. Well, 10 or 20. That I was almost in the lines. Surely you can let me off for that. Or you get to hear the sob stories. Well, I was just taking my friend to the doctor's, or I was just picking up some flowers for a funeral. And then you have to take the abuse. Over and over being shouted at for simply doing your job. But then Tom Wright goes on to say, if that wasn't bad enough, imagine that the traffic warden was working for a hostile government that you wanted rid of. And that these laws had just been introduced and you were just parking in the place that you'd done so for the last 20 years without penalty. And now you're being penalized for doing what you've spent the rest of your life doing without difficulty. And then suppose that this traffic warden could set their own level of fine, just so that he or she could take a cut, a sizable cut. You could see that the traffic warden wouldn't be the most popular person in town. Chances are that this tax collector, Levi, the son of Alphaeus, hadn't grown up wanting to be a tax collector. I don't think he chose the job, but rather it was probably the only job that he could find. And we don't know if he supported the rulers at that time, but it's unlikely because most Jews didn't. And then one day we read, Jesus came past. Jesus came past, and we simply read, he saw him. He saw this tax collector. I don't know if any of you watch television coverage of big events, of sporting fixtures. Often in that coverage, during a break, the camera will pan round across the crowd, and you'll see this sea of faces, and then suddenly at one point, someone will see themselves on the big screen, and they will suddenly wave and shout, recognizing that they've got their 5 seconds of fame. They've gone from being an anonymous face in the crowd to being, as they see it at least, the center of attention. If we go back to thinking about Levi, this man who was seen to be in cahoots with the occupying force. We later read that he was sort of categorized along with tax collectors and sinners. That's how he was seen. Would have been overlooked and shunned by society. Lumped in with the worst of the worst. But he was seen by Jesus. Reminded of the story of Hagar in Genesis 16. Hagar, you might remember, became pregnant by Abraham, the idea being suggested by Abraham's wife Sarah, so that he might have an heir. But then Hagar had to flee as Sarai turned on her. So she flees, but then she's met by an angel and told to return, and we read this in Genesis 16:13. Thereafter, Hagar used another name to refer to the Lord who had spoken to her. She said, you are the God who sees me. God is a God who sees us. In this passage this morning, we see God in Christ seeing this hated tax collector. seeing him not as a sinner, but as an individual who needed love and acceptance. God this morning sees all of us, all of you, not just as one of a congregation, but he sees you as an individual. He sees what you're going through. He sees the challenges and the difficulties that you face. I just encourage you this morning, if that particularly resonates with you, to allow that truth to speak to your heart. God sees you. God sees you as an individual. It might be that you feel as if you're just overlooked, as if you're a face in the crowd. But this morning, as that camera pans round of God's gaze, he sees you. He loves you. He speaks to you this morning. So Jesus sees Levi. Levi, who was used to being shouted at, moaned at, sworn at. Jesus doesn't do that. Jesus speaks to Levi and simply says, "Follow me." And Levi does just that. We don't know the history. We don't know what encounter they might have had before. But in this moment, we see that Levi recognizes something in the person of Jesus. Sees something of who God is. And no doubt with a look of astonishment on his face, gets up and follows Jesus. Maybe it was the first time for a long time that he'd been treated like a human being rather than a piece of dirt. Jesus sees him, says, "Follow me," and Levi responds. Does the same to each of us. As he sees us as an individual, not a face in a crowd, he sees us and he calls us to follow. Whether that's the first time this morning or whether that's the 100th time, whether that's the 1,000th time, he calls each of us to follow and to go on following. He calls you not worrying about who you are, what you've done or what you might have had done to you. He calls you kindly and compassionately and says, "Come, follow me." And then for the religious types who were watching on, if that wasn't bad enough, Jesus calling this tax collector to go and follow him, we read this. While Jesus was having dinner at Levi's house, many tax collectors and sinners were eating with him and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. Speaking to this man was bad enough, but sharing a meal took it to another level. Jesus sits down. Well, actually, he lies down, we read. He reclines with them and eats with Levi and his friends. This so-called group of tax collectors and sinners. You see, the Levites wanted to see these people excluded. They wanted to find a reason to push these people away. And they wanted everyone else to follow suit. Because what the Pharisees did was they took the Old Testament laws and they added a separate second layer around them, if you like, of secondary laws. And now they said this because what they wanted to do was kind of keep people as far away from breaking the laws as possible. So they put these extra laws in place to be something of a safety barrier, if you like. But then over time, these secondary laws were enforced as if they were the primary ones. And the meaning of the law itself was lost because there were so many rules and regulations to follow. back in the year 2000, there was a man, Kevin Story. He was driving on the M3 near Winchester, and he was doing 68 miles an hour in a 50 mile an hour zone. He was spotted by the police, who pulled him over. But they didn't charge him with speeding, and he was travelling nearly 20 miles an hour over the limit. They charged him because he was eating a Kit Kat whilst he was driving. A Kit Kat that had been handed to him by a passenger, already unwrapped, so he wasn't unwrapping it. But they said that he was driving and was distracted, and he was given a £20 on-the-spot fine, albeit one that was turned over on appeal. Legalism focuses on the minor faults and blows them out of all proportion. Where the Pharisees saw rules being broken and people to be excluded, Jesus saw people to be loved, to draw close to spend time with, to demonstrate the reality of the kingdom of God. My wife and I have recently become foster carers, and I was reading a blog as I was preparing for this. It was written by an American foster carer and author, Jason Johnson, and he says this: in 2016, a Santa Clara man saved a total stranger from a burning car. The car was on fire and the driver incoherent. Some onlookers watched in the parking lot while others recorded the whole thing on their phones. Only one person jumped in to help. His name was Aram. After realizing the seriousness of the situation just a few yards ahead of him, he noticed everyone else was understandably moving away from the burning car, but he never stopped moving towards it. And then with one swift move, Aram grabbed the man from behind the wheel and pulled him to safety. When later asked by reporters why he did it, Aram matter-of-factly responded, "No one was pulling him out. I figured if I don't, he's going to die. So why not me?" Johnson goes on to write this: moving towards hard places is not what we do. In light of the gospel, it's who we are. We are the kind of people who move towards hard places and broken people because that's exactly who Jesus has been for us. We move towards, not away. And when we do, it says something true about Jesus, about who Jesus is in our lives. Our friends might look at us as if we're crazy. Our families might look at us as if we're crazy. We might look in the mirror sometimes and ask ourselves why we're being crazy. And everyone is right. It's crazy. It's crazy that God would do this for us. And it's crazy that he would invite us to do it for others. It's crazy because it screams completely counterintuitive to the way we've all been hardwired to live, to avoid, to isolate, to insulate. It's crazy and beautiful and ugly and worth it. And if we're honest, it's a difficult thing for us to justify our raising our hands in praise to a God that moves towards us in our brokenness while simultaneously using those same hands to push the brokenness of others away. We can't do it, church. We simply can't. That's not who we are. The call to follow Jesus is the call to move towards the brokenness of the world, to seek to embrace rather than to exclude. And there is something within that proximity with others, meaning that we see beyond the stereotypes and the media portrayals. Rather than seeing difference, we suddenly see similarity. Rather than seeing the crowd, we see the individual. If we go back to the way that Jesus saw Levi, the way in which he sees you and me, we're called to see others, to draw near to them, to get to know them, not to win them, but to be a friend. to see the potential. I think I've lost. I've broken the tech. Sorry. You won't have me back, will you? We'll go on without the PowerPoint. Can I try once more? Yes, okay, it's working now. Sorry about that. We're called to draw near to people, to see them as an individual, just as Christ sees us as an individual. To see the potential diamond in the dirt and the dust. Jesus saw the beauty of all God's children. He ate and drank with tax collectors, met with prostitutes, even the despised Samaritans. He met them, he spent time with them to show them what love and acceptance looked like, to demonstrate the reality of the kingdom of God. Jesus was then challenged about what it was he was doing. Well, his disciples were challenged, and the Pharisees said, "Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners?" Jesus overheard and responded by saying, "It's not the healthy that need a doctor, but those who are ill. I've not come to call the righteous, but sinners." Doctors can't keep their distance from those that are unwell. We saw this with tragic consequences during the COVID pandemic. Doctors move close, draw towards those who are ill and those who are hurting. It's part of what they do, it's who they are. In the same way, Jesus was to spend time with the tax collectors and the sinners, the outcasts and the unwelcome, because they needed to know his love and his welcome and his acceptance. Something that he calls us to share with the world. George Whitefield said this, "True grace will not be content eating mere morsels, but will want to bring others to feast on the delights that are ours in Christ Jesus." We draw close to others, offering them that welcome and that acceptance that Christ has offered us. So there are two points that I'm trying to pass on this morning. One is an encouragement, that encouragement that Christ sees you this morning. He sees you as an individual. He sees what you're going through. And he calls you to follow him. And the second, something more of a challenge. Do we exclude or do we embrace? Do we seek to move away from the hurt and the pain of the world? Or do we move closer to it? Offering that love that Christ has offered us. Let's take a moment to be still, to pause, asking the Lord as an individual, what is it that you're saying to me this morning? What is it that I need to do to respond? Let's just be still. Loving God, I pray this morning in particular for any who might feel overlooked, might feel unloved, unwelcome. I pray that even in this moment, that they might know your loving gaze, your embrace, your welcome and your love. May they know, may we all know, that we're seen by you, that we're loved by you. And loving God, I pray for us all that rather in any way excluding others, that we might be drawn to the pain and the suffering in the world, that we might demonstrate the reality of your kingdom here on earth. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Simon. It leaves us something to think about, doesn't it? God knows you. He knows me. He knows our inner being. It's quite strange, when I was listening to that, I was thinking of Andy, funny enough. What he's doing on sabbatical, going out to find out different things about what's happening in the communities through other churches, how they're working in their communities. We're ineffective sat in here. We're really effective if we get out there. And it's our friends, our families, people we don't know in our communities yet, that we need to share God's love with. We need to be out there. We know he's going to give us the strength to do it. And this church will double in size if we get out there and we show the love of Jesus to our community. It's not going to be easy. Not the best thing in the world to do. I hate it. I really find it difficult. But I know with God's love, if he's in me and he's keeping me filled with his love and his care, he will give me the strength to get out there. And we need to get out there, because this world, when you look around, needs Jesus. And it needs Jesus now. We're going to sing How Deep the Father's Love, How Vast Beyond All Measure. Oh, no, we're not. That's one we've already done, isn't it? There you go. Love before the dawn of time, chosen by the Maker. There you go. We're going to sing that salvation song, because God is our salvation. Let's stand and sing. And at the end of this song, those that are serving communion, if they'd like to come up to the chairs, that'll be wonderful.
He is there to lift me.
We gather at this table to celebrate life, the life of God in the world, made flesh and blood in Jesus, embodied in us. We come to remember the body that was broken, the hands that touched the untouchable, healed the hurting, and did no violence. The feet that got dusty along city streets and at lake shores. The arms that welcomed the stranger and embraced the outcast. The legs that entered homes and synagogues and danced at celebrations. The eyes that blazed against injustice. Knew how to cry and saw the potential in everyone. The belly that shared table with unexpected people and shook with laughter. The lips that wove stories and painted pictures of a new community and a better world. This blessed body that was broken, abused, and rejected, we come to remember. For we are called to be the body of Christ. And as you, risen Christ, remember our lives, so we remember you, not only at this table, but in our life together. May we embody your kingdom and remember your life for the world. The Apostle Paul wrote these familiar words, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Just as Jesus gave thanks before sharing the bread and the wine, so will we. We're going to be led in prayer.
Shall we pray? Lord Jesus, we stand amazed in your presence and wonder how you could love us, sinners, condemned, unclean, but you do. Lord, the love you have for us is amazing and limitless. And as we share and remember communion now, we're reminded that you gave yourself for us. You gave your body, and your precious blood was shed for the forgiveness of our sins. Lord, accept our thanks, our praise, our worship, because this morning only you are worthy. Amen.
This broken bread that we share is the body of Christ, It is a sign of all that we live and risk together as the community of Christ. Let all who seek Christ take and eat. We eat the bread as we receive it, giving thanks for that sacrifice that Christ made for us. The cup that we drink is the wine of the kingdom of God, the sign of God's undertaking for the life of the world. Let all who seek Christ take and drink. When we receive a glass, we hold on to it, and then we drink together as a sign of our unity as God's people in this place. Thank you. drink this, remember, and be thankful. We've taken bread and wine into our bodies. Now may these hands be the hands of Christ in the world. May they do no violence. May these eyes see those who are overlooked. May these ears listen to those who are unheard. May these voices be raised for the voiceless, lest our songs of praise be empty. May these feet take us where Christ leads, and may these hearts and minds be open to your Spirit. Christ has remembered us. May we remember Christ. Amen.
As we come to the end of our service this morning, if anybody feels that they need prayer or someone to talk to, then over that far side in the far corner there'll be people there willing to share with you and to care for you. Remember, tea and coffee afterwards, they're in the new places. Please feel free to go and make your own tea and coffee and then come sit back in the middle and share fellowship together, that people can talk together and praise together. And thank you, Simon, for your message this morning. That's wonderful. Last song says, with every breath I long to follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home. And day by day I know he will renew me until I stand with joy before the throne. Let's stand together and sing, Yet Not I, But in Christ in Me.
Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and he was raised to overthrow the grave.
My sin has been defeated. Jesus, now and ever is
not I, but through Christ in me. Father, we go knowing that we need to serve you. Father, we know that you love us so much that we want you to go with us. Take us now out into our communities, out into our homes, out into our work, wherever we be. Go with us, Lord, and may we serve you diligently. And may we praise your name. Amen.
Amen.
Throne.